Good morning, good morning, and welcome to the Brenda Perryman Show right here on TV 33, WHPR, Comcast 90 and 91, all over the world, courtesy of the World Wide Web. And we have a great show for you this morning. On my second segment, I have gospel singers, the Sounds of Imani. And on my first show, and we're doing Table Talk at 10 today, and we have a lot of controversial issues. But I'm so delighted to have my first guest. I chased after him and chased after him, and now he's here. Dr. Antoine Garibaldi. Good morning, good morning.
Good morning, Brenda.
He is the president of the University of Detroit Mercy, or should I say Detroit Mercy?
Well, you can say both.
Oh, okay. I just don't want to, I want to be politically correct here, because you all have now changed it.
Right. We've done a rebranding, which officially we rolled out back in September, and we have a new logo, a new brand line, which is Build a Boundless Future. And so the university consolidated 26 years ago, but this is really the first time that we have rolled out a new brand. And so University of Detroit Mercy is the name that we refer to, and also Detroit Mercy.
Oh, okay. That's all good. That is all good. Now, you are the 25th president of the university.
Yes.
You've been the president for 6 years.
Pretty close to that, yes.
And if I knew nothing about the university and I asked you to describe it, what would you say?
Well, the first thing I would say is that the University of Detroit Mercy has a rich history, both from the Society of Jesus, the Jesuits, and also the Sisters of Mercy. And the University of Detroit was founded in 1877. It's actually one of the 15th oldest of the 28 Jesuit universities in the United States.
Oh, they're 28 and Jesuit?
There are 28 Jesuit universities in the United States, all across the country. And in the Sisters of Mercy founded Mercy College of Detroit in 1941. And in 1990, the two institutions came together as one. And as an institution, we have more than 5,000 students today with our School of Law, School of Dentistry, Architecture, Business, College of Health Professions, also Liberal Arts and Education. And these programs are extremely important to the future of Detroit and also the future of the nation.
What would you say sets aside the University of Detroit Mercy from other universities in our area?
Well, I would say that, first of all, we have been here for a very, very long time. Right. Wayne State certainly can claim the same. Wayne State's about 10 years older than we are. But our mission has always been focused on not just the intellectual preparation of young men and women, but also the focus on service to our community and also social justice. Social justice has been a very, very important aspect of the university's history throughout. And so we are very, very proud to say that with our three campuses, we have never left the city of Detroit.
Yes.
Like many Jesuit universities, some of which people in the city know, that name and association with a city is extremely important. So when you think of St. Louis University, that or Seattle University, those are Jesuit universities, and they are very much the heart of those two particular communities.
Okay, wow. You know, this University of Detroit, I'm going to say what it used to be called.
Okay.
I'm doing that for a reason. University of Detroit was like the Holy Grail when I was in high school.
Mm.
Seriously, as far as basketball or was concerned, it was the big house.
Right.
That's where we went for our districts and all of that. But academia, it was like the mount.
Right. Well, you know, a lot of that history continues. I mean, in terms of athletics, we have 19 Division I sports. We
19?
Also, 19.
I didn't
19,
realize
that's
that.
That's right, 19. And more than 300 young men and women who are student athletes and also exceptional students. We still host lots of the tournaments, for example, for basketball. We host a lot of the public and also the private softball championships as well, too. So we are still very much ingrained in the community.
Where do you play the softball?
We have a Bicey Field named after one of our alums who's been a very, very strong supporter right there, right off of Livernois. So, when weather gets a little bit warmer in springtime, you can come and see our softball team as well as see some of the high school teams that come and play. Some of them sometimes are playing on Saturdays and Sundays.
Right, right. Well, I've been over there for a few times. I'm there here and there.
Right.
Seriously, because sometimes they even have programs for young children, and I've brought my grandson over to some. In one of the buildings. I forgot the name. Now we're going to go a little back in time.
Okay.
We're going to go and see where you came from. Tell our audience a little about your background.
Well, I'm a native of New Orleans, and cold weather does not bother me since I lived in Erie, Pennsylvania for 10 years before I came to Detroit in 2011. I was president of Gannon University, which is also a Catholic university.
Gannon
is a Catholic university in Erie, Pennsylvania, founded by Archbishop John Mark Gannon in the 1930s. But my background is really primarily, I grew up in New Orleans. I spent 8.5 years as a seminarian in New York.
Oh, you were thinking about becoming a priest?
I was. I was in the seminary for 8.5 years.
Gee.
So during the course of my education preparation in Newburgh, New York, and then Washington, D.C.
I'm familiar with my cousin graduated from Mount St. Mary's College.
Oh, I know that very well. In fact, it's not very far from where I was in Newburgh. So so I was there in Washington, D.C. So my undergraduate degree is from Howard University and went to graduate school at the University of Minnesota.
Now, what took you to Howard? Why Howard?
Well, at the time, the seminary that I was in was the Josephite Fathers, the Society of St. Joseph of the Sacred Heart, predominantly white order of priests who focused their attention on the African-American communities, the black Catholics throughout the South. Baltimore and Washington were two of the primary areas. Baltimore was the headquarters. But many of black Catholics in the South, particularly Louisiana, Mississippi, Texas, Alabama, and Georgia, and as far away as over in California, were really educated by the Josephite Fathers, and at that time in the 60s, that was a very keen interest of mine. The Josephites have really made lots of contributions. I will say that one of my rectors, who just really recently passed away, was a native of Detroit, and Detroit was a place where many vocations came from as well. So that was one of the reasons why that was a focus there. Of us going to Howard University, it was felt that it would be good for us we majored in sociology and philosophy, and really to be a part of the community. So I was very active in both Washington, D.C. and Baltimore when I was a seminarian in the early 70s.
Okay, and did you always want to go into the educational field?
Well, I think it gradually became a part of my interest as I got more involved in working in the community. I'm one of 9 children. I'm not the oldest. I'm 6th in the family. But my older brothers and sisters began to pursue education as an interest, and that was one of the keen interests of mine. So I started out doing volunteer work with 5th and 6th graders in Washington, D.C., and then went on to be the principal of an alternative high school in St. Paul, of an alternative high school when I was in graduate school. So it kind of gradually just caught my interest.
So you taught the 5th and 6th graders?
I did.
And then you became a principal of a high school?
When I was in graduate school, the Urban League at the time had Urban League Street Academies around the country. There were about 15 of them.
Right.
I often remark that I used to go to Urban League conferences and conventions. I always used to see Dr. Carnegie. And Dr. Carnegie knew I was in graduate school and also leading the Urban League Street Academy in St. Paul. And that was a great experience for me. I often tell students it was probably one of the best experiences in my life because it was a program where our goal was to get young men and women who had really kind of given up on education or gotten involved, unfortunately, in the juvenile justice system and had stopped going to school. And our job was really to make sure that those young women graduated from high school. So some of them have been suspended and expelled from schools, not once, but maybe twice or more. And it's really refreshing to know that today, many of those young men and women are not only productive citizens, but several of them became teachers.
Well, yeah, and then they saw how it was.
Exactly.
They saw how it was. And it just, and I do understand what you mean about the alternative education system too, because some, you know, no children learn the same way.
No.
And sometimes teachers expect students to learn the same way they did.
Exactly.
Which is very wrong,
right,
in my opinion. But you can meet those children where they are, and they can become productive citizens. And you've just talked about that. Also, as I read your autobiography, it's so much to it. You've been all over, and you've done so much in education. And I wanted to know, how did you get to University of Detroit Mercy?
Well, I've been very fortunate to be involved in education, and I will tell you that I knew a lot about University of Detroit Mercy before I came here, but because I am the first lay president of the university, the likelihood that someone other than a member of the Jesuits or maybe Sister Mercy or like my good friend Sister Maureen Faye, who was president for 14 years.
Yes, she was.
So I had a little, let's say a little convincing of people said, you know, you really should apply for the job since you've been a president of another Catholic university and have been associated with it. So, but one of the things that really caught my interest was the fact that this was a university that was really focused on the city and on the community. Education was also a very important concern of my board of trustees, and they really wanted to have someone who would be able to be engaged in that as well as running the university. So this is really kind of an ideal situation in much the same way my experiences at both Xavier University in New Orleans for 15 years and Howard University for 5 years.
Xavier was very popular. One of my, I had students who went down there too. It was because people would get it mixed up sometimes with the Xavier in Cincinnati.
Exactly, yeah.
Now, Xavier in Cincinnati is a Catholic university too.
Xavier University in Cincinnati is a Jesuit university.
Okay.
So it's one of our close sister institutions.
Oh, okay. Now, University of Detroit Mercy is really, really involved in the community, or maybe it's been highlighted more, but it's so involved in the community. It seems like every time I look at something else, why do you think being involved is important for the university?
Well, the university has been involved for a very, very long time, and I think the most important thing is that most of the residents of Detroit recognize the fact that the University of Detroit Mercy has been here for 139 years and now 140 years as we're starting off 2017, and has never left. And in 1967, with the riots and other civil disturbance, there was a great push on the part of many individuals, alumni, friends of the university, to leave the city, like so many other educational institutions did. The Jesuits were very committed to the city, and so were the Sisters of Mercy, and said that we are not leaving. This is where our roots are, and this is the community that we continue to serve. Our activity in the immediate community over the last 5 years, and not just here, but also in Corktown and also downtown, where our School of Law is and where the Dental School is in Corktown, we have really engaged the residents of those neighborhoods as well as the businesses to provide the kind of assistance that we think that we can provide as an educational institution. Our students love being involved with the community. They love the service work.
It seems like we hear more about it now.
Well, we've been doing a pretty good job of promoting it. But also, I would say that we have increased it. I shared with you a copy of our economic impact document, which is available online for any of your listeners.
They should
to
really,
see.
really they should really take a look at that and how the dollars generated back into the community, the school, the community.
Right.
And that's very important. And you say you have 5,000 students?
We have 5,000 students. I mentioned most of the schools and colleges. I'll get in trouble if I don't mention the College of Engineering and Science, which I think
well,
I left
we're
out
going to
the
talk
beginning
about,
of.
Yeah,
okay.
We're going to talk about that. I've been so impressed about the Fitzgerald Project. Can you tell our audience about the Fitzgerald neighborhood and the project?
Well, sure. The Fitzgerald Project is one that's a collaboration between the City of Detroit University and also Marygrove College. This is spurred by a recent grant from the John and James L. Knight Foundation, which is providing $4 million to our partners in order to make some significant changes in the Fitzgerald neighborhood, which
could,
is just to
could
the
we
east.
Tell the audience where the Fitzgerald neighborhood is located?
Sure. So the Fitzgerald neighborhood is west of the campus, so just off of McNichols Road. And also, I would say the bordering street is really the service road on the Lodge Freeway going north and goes down to Wyoming, to Marygrove College. And that particular area is an area that has been a focus for a number of years, in part because of the fact that there are lots of dilapidated homes, there are a lot of vacant homes in that neighborhood. There has been really an exodus of businesses along McNichols along McNichols Road. And our emphasis has been to do what we can in order to revitalize it. So the Knight Foundation's $4 million grant, plus some other initiatives that are becoming from the Kresge Foundation, are going to be used with the city's implementation of demolishing a number of those dilapidated and vacant homes. There is going to be a greenway that will be developed over
What's
the next.
What's a greenway?
Well, a greenway is going to be a walkway, an area where young folks and older folks can ride their bicycles along the way. When the buildings are, when the vacant buildings are torn down, we'll make some, some little, almost like, it won't be urban farms, but the
green
little
spaces.
The green spaces and orchards until someone is ready to build a home there. But there will be some bike lanes also along Livernois Avenue as well. But the whole intent is really to beautify that area from Marygrove College all the way to Livernois and to the university.
That used to be such a beautiful area, and it does still have some jewels in it.
Oh, no question about it.
There
are some very active residents.
Very.
Young man, Gaston Nash, has been leading up the Fitzgerald neighborhood organization for about the last 3 years. Gaston's in his early 30s and an engineer by profession, and has just really been very active working with the community. But that's one of those neighborhoods that we know is going to be blossoming over the next several years, both literally and figuratively.
So what exactly will be generated from the university?
Well, the university is an active partner. You know, myself, as well as many other individuals at the university, our School of Architecture is and has been a very active component of the city redevelopment. Dan Patera, who leads the Detroit Collaborative Design Center, and many of his staff, as well as other architecture faculty, have been working with nonprofit institutions for over the last 22, 23 years. And what they provide are services that many nonprofits could never afford. And through the help of our foundation partners, we've been able to provide those services to individuals and organizations for free. So the university is actively involved in that project, just as it is with Live Six Alliance, which we
And we're going to talk about the Live Six Alliance. That's so exciting.
Right. So the university has included some of its in-kind services, manpower and person power, as well as some financial resources in order to make sure that the entire neighborhood nearby is enhanced. And the same holds true for some of our work along Puritan, just to the south of the campus. We want to do much more in the area of Puritan and Pilgrim Village, Martin Park, certainly University District.
Well, I have been so impressed with the number of volunteers from the university. That is just wonderful. What do? You just put out a clarion call for them?
We put out a clarion call. We have our alumni who are very actively involved in it, our faculty, our staff. You may have seen earlier in the school year that some of our first-year students, we engaged them in a project in the Fitzgerald neighborhood, primarily to do some cleaning up and also some painting in the neighborhood. They did a little work, then the city came along and did some boarding up of houses to make it a safe place. What a better way for a student to begin his or her college education than to begin it with service. And that is so important. And so we hear that while most of our students are from the state of Michigan, we have students from outside of the area. We have students who come from north and west Michigan. They are coming to the city of Detroit and University of Detroit Mercy in particular so that they can be involved in the Renaissance that is underway and one that will continue to blossom over the next few years.
Well, is it the Live 6 Alliance?
Live 6 Alliance.
Tell our audience about that, please.
Sure. Well, Live 6 Alliance is a name that we have developed for this an economic development corporation. It is a nonprofit. It is separate from the university. Uh-huh. I serve as the chair of it. We have other individuals who are also members of the board. But Live 6 is a play on words of live for Livinois and 6 for 6 Mile. So that's the immediate area in which we tend to focus our efforts. We have 4 primary goals, and one is called placemaking. The other is neighborhood stabilization. The third is business attraction and retention. And the fourth is safety and security.
Very important. Are they listed in that order?
They are listed in that order, and I'll tell you how that came about. We know that the residents in the Fitzgerald neighborhood in particular want to be more engaged, and our students in the School of Architecture's Master of Community Development program particularly surveyed those residents probably about 5 or 6 years ago, uh-huh. and they said, in order for you to stay here, what would be most important? And placemaking is just another code word for engagement, and we consider ourselves to be the convener of conversations. We are not taking over any of the neighborhoods. We want to be a facilitator in this process. So that's an important development, so that just like when I came to the university, I went around, I met with people, I met with the different groups. I wanted them to know me, but I wanted to know much more from them. And so we want them at the table. Neighborhood stabilization is key.
Very.
And so everybody wants to make sure that their property is enhanced with some additional resources. Business attraction and retention. We have great businesses in the neighborhood along McNichols and Livernois.
Eric's, I've been framed.
Eric's is one of several. And then we also have some new programs that are going to be coming online as a result of Motor City Match. And the Detroit Economic Growth Corporation has been a major player in that. So in order for us to keep the businesses that currently exist and to attract others, we need to have some stimulus and some catalyst. So we have 2 co-directors, Lauren Hood and then Michael Forsythe, who's coming from the Detroit Economic Growth Corporation as we speak to begin this initiative. And we've really been in existence for about a year and a half, but we're going to really be doing some active
things. Well, that last tenet, which is very important,
Absolutely.
The safety piece.
Safety.
Because, you know, we talk about that. A lot of, I meet a lot of business people who want to start their businesses and they want to have a storefront or something.
Correct.
They can, you know, be somewhere they could be located easily and so forth. And safety is their main.
Right. Well, that's one of the reasons. I mean, we have some older residents in the neighborhood.
Yes.
We have some younger residents in the neighborhood as well, and they consider that to be extremely important. They certainly appreciate the nearby resources of the university, but the 12th Precinct has been a very, very good collaborator with the university. We host some of the CompStat meetings on campus, which identifies where the crimes have occurred, over the past month, and we have a relatively safe neighborhood, yes, considering lots of other nearby campuses where there might be universities as well as residents. So there is a focused effort on that, and Chief Craig has been very supportive of that. I serve on the Chief Citizens Advisory Committee.
Good.
And as he looks at other neighborhoods, he and all of his deputies, they recognize that that's an extremely important area of the city. And so we want the rest of the Livernois area to be as strong as the Avenue of Fashion between 7 Mile and 8 Mile.
Yeah, well, I think it could be. I think it could be.
It is coming.
But lastly, I'd like to talk about the Detroit Collaborative Design Center.
Sure.
And they just received a Whitney M. Young Award.
Yes, they did. Yeah.
So
which
why
is
don't
the
you
highest.
Tell?
Sure. Well, you know, as I mentioned, Dan Patera, and he has lots of wonderful staff, many of them younger, and some of them a little bit more mature, like myself. But I'm not a member of his staff, but I'm a great promoter for it. The Detroit Collaborative Design Center has been around for 23 years, and they submitted some of their projects that they've been working on here in the city of Detroit, and they received this outstanding award from the National Architectural Association, and it's a real feather in their cap. It's a feather in the cap of the city of Detroit.
Absolutely.
For the outstanding work that it's done. And so they were selected among all of the urban design centers in this entire country for that award. And so some of your listeners can go to the website and see some of the highlights of that and also some of the designs that were submitted.
Wow, that is very fantastic. I was so excited when I saw that. And some of these projects or the things that they've designed will be coming to Detroit.
Absolutely. And we have hosted the meetings of the national organization, I think a few summers ago. We're the host of that. I should also say that our School of Architecture is the only one of the 28 Jesuit universities and also 16 Sisters of Mercy institutions that has a School of Architecture. So our School of Architecture in name is really about 54 years old, but way back in the 50s and early 40s, we had architectural engineering degrees, and we have some outstanding architects, and I'm happy to see a lot of our local students from the Detroit Public Schools and many of the schools around the area who are coming to the university. We're one of only three schools of architecture in the state of Michigan.
Well, if some of my viewers are watching and they're interested, maybe there might be some in their early 20s or some in their 40s or more who would like to be come to the University of Detroit Mercy, perhaps to matriculate.
Absolutely.
Or to get back into the game or to change their career changing.
Absolutely. Well, we welcome all individuals. We welcome them to come and visit. We know a lot of people come over to Callahan Hall for some of our basketball games.
Yes, they do.
We have a lot of our residents in the neighborhood who walk our track every day, particularly from the immediate area. And so I think that they would be very impressed if they came to the McNichols campus and saw some of that, as well as our many individuals who are served through our School of Dentistry every day. 26,000 patients are served every year through our clinic in the School of Dentistry. And our School of Law has close to 10 clinics.
Oh, and that's what I wanted to mention real quick before we go, is the School of Law. They do some pro bono work, don't they?
Yes. And much of that work
that means
comes
free.
Right. And that's been going on for quite a while. Our School of Law is 105 years old this year. And since about 1965, we have probably one of the four oldest law clinics in the entire country. And many of our alumni who are practicing and some have retired since that time really cut their teeth on some of those services. So immigration services.
That's what I was going to mention, the immigration services also.
Immigration services, veteran services. We provide assistance for individuals with in the areas of juvenile justice and also appellate court and mortgage and foreclosure.
How would people find out about that?
Well, they can go to the website and there we have the George Asher Law Clinic, which is diagonally across the street right downtown on Lauren, and that clinic is actually today in an old firehouse that was just diagonally across the street from Saints Peter and Paul's. So everyone knows where the Renaissance Center is. All you do is just walk down the street there, and there is our law center. We serve so many people throughout the year.
Dr. Garibaldi, I am just so impressed with what the University of Detroit Mercy is doing, or Detroit Mercy, as I've been told I can say, is doing. And I'd like to compliment you on your tie, which picks up the colors of the university.
Well, that certainly was by design.
Yeah,
so thanks very much for that.
I've been looking at that. I said, I know about that school. So, ladies and gentlemen, you heard it here from the professor, the president, who has been all over. And I'm very proud of you. You're also the first African-American president also.
Yes.
And that is very important. And anytime someone does something, it's a feather in all of our caps.
Well, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to talk about the university and our students.
Well, I want to have you back. Let's get to spring. Let's see once we get these projects, because the projects really affect a lot of my viewers.
Yes, and I'd love to come back, and it's great, as I said, for people just to come over and see what's going on. I think
they'll
be very impressed.
And you had that homecoming this year, too.
We had homecoming in late September, but they don't have to wait to homecoming to come and come on back in the springtime and in the wintertime. The campus is beautiful all year round.
Yes. Well, this is the man who should have that job. He's a proponent, and you've made so many of us a proponent. So thank you very, very much.
Thank you very much.